Carl Sagan once famously wrote, "We are made of star stuff." It's certainly poetic, but it doesn't tell the whole story. For one thing, it ignores the fact that some elements don't have to be made in stars at all. Your body is roughly 10% hydrogen, and the bulk of that element was made moments after the Big Bang, millions and millions of years before the first stars were born. But "we are made of 90-ish percent star stuff" doesn't sound as nice. That's not what this episode is about, though, because the other issue I have with this saying is that it just ignores how complicated it is to make some of the other elements that are inside you. And some elements that are technically inside of you in trace amounts, like gold, are so hard to explain the origins of that scientists don't actually know how it all got there. Let's pull out our handy-dandy periodic table. Up here, we've got your hydrogen and helium, which mostly came from the loose soup of subatomic particles that dominated the very early universe. The next lightest elements, lithium, beryllium, and boron, can also be made without stars getting involved. But for everything heavier than that, we start to need those stellar engines, along with some even more intense processes. Let's start with the one that scientists figured out first. Nuclear fusion. In this super cool process, which is actually super hot, atomic nuclei run into each other at such wildly high speeds they smoosh together. Fusion is why stars shine, and they keep doing it for millions, if not trillions of years, depending on how massive they are. Now, technically, there's more than one kind of stellar fusion process, producing different kinds of elements. And which one happens depends on what kind of star you have and where it is in its life cycle. But as impressive as it all sounds, fusion has its element creation limit. Eventually, you get less energy out of making a heavier element than you have to put in, which grinds that hot stellar furnace to a halt. In even the most massive stars, the heaviest element it can reliably make is iron, which it only does at the very last moment of its life. You can get some nickel at the very, very end of the fusion process, but it's radioactive and doesn't stick around very long. But if you grab your closest copy of the periodic table, you'll see there are way more elements on it that are heavier than iron, including some of humanity's favorites, like gold and platinum. They're not made by the Big Bang or by stellar fusion, but by a secret third thing called neutron capture. There are also secret fourth, fifth, and sixth things to making elements, but we'll have to leave that for another time. This process starts with just a little seed nucleus, made up of just a few protons and neutrons. Then, if that nucleus finds itself inside an environment where there's a truly enormous amount of neutrons packed almost impossibly close together, something wild can happen. Neutrons have neutral charges, so unlike their proton siblings, they aren't repelled by each other's electric charges or by those protons either. So if there's a ton of them, they can all start to glom onto that nucleus. But those neutrons aren't stable. Eventually, they decay into protons, plus some other subatomic particles that don't matter right now. And since it's the number of protons that determines what element you are, all those new protons turn the nucleus into a new, heavier element. Those neutrons don't all decay at once, though. And all the while, even more neutrons outside the ball are avoiding the FOMO and globbing on as well. That rate of glomming can be either slower or faster than the rate the neutrons are decaying, which is why this neutron capture process comes in two main flavors. The first that astronomers identified is called the S process, which stands for slow process. Slow here meaning that new neutrons stick to their seed nucleus slower than the nucleus forms protons. This version of neutron capture is known to happen in certain low-mass red giant stars, called AGB stars, and, to a lesser extent, massive old stars. But according to scientists, if you look at the universe and measure all the different elements that could be made by the S process, there's too much matter for the S process to account for. So there must be another process making these elements. Enter the rapid process, or R process. Now, the neutrons are being added to the seed nucleus way faster than they can decay into protons. The R process can only happen in environments where the neutron density is way higher than where you'd find the S process. And those environments are much rarer in space, meaning it was way harder to prove that the R process was even real. For a long time, scientists thought the first evidence would come from supernovas, the violent death of a massive star, or an equally violent outburst from the core of a long-dead star that accidentally siphoned too much gas off a stellar neighbor. But upon closer examination, no dice. Supernovas don't seem to be able to facilitate the R process. We were back to square one. Until, that is, another idea that had been lurking in the background stepped into the spotlight. In 1974, two astronomers published a paper that analyzed the nuclear physics of black hole neutron star mergers. Neutron stars are the remnants of stars that were massive enough to go supernova, but not so massive their cores completely collapsed into black holes. So they're chock full of neutrons, packed as closely as the laws of physics allow. In theory, the short-range gravitational forces and neutron abundances combined to create the perfect environment for the R process. And on further investigations, mergers between two neutron stars seemed to work too. But basically no one believed the theory because they were all so focused on supernovas. Eventually, thanks to modeling software getting better and better, it became obvious that it is really hard to make the R process work in supernovas. There just aren't enough neutrons present. And some even smaller particles, called neutrinos, tend to convert the neutrons that are there into protons before they can ball up around their seed nuclei. But the merger scenario not only stayed possible, it started to seem pretty likely. And eventually, scientists got the piece of evidence they needed to confirm it. But before I can reveal what that evidence was, we've got to keep the lights on. So here's an ad.
Thanks to Jump for supporting this SciShow video. Jump is a statistical analysis software designed to help you with all your analytics needs. And in the world of analytics, there can be a lot of needs, like when you have so many variables that you need Jump's predictor screening to highlight the most meaningful ones and avoid wasting your energy on the other ones. Or when you need Jump's principal component analysis and partial least squares regression to figure out which of those variables have the biggest impact on your dataset. From screening to transformations, Jump has you covered through your whole data analysis process. You can check them out with a 30-day free trial for anyone, anywhere at jmp.com/scishow.
In 2017, the gravitational wave detectors LIGO and Virgo both captured an event known as GW170817. But researchers didn't know what caused that event, at least not right away. It could have just been another merger between two black holes, but upon further investigation, it turned out to be the merger of two neutron stars. Because when they smashed into each other, they didn't just create a bunch of gravitational ripples in space-time. Unlike a pair of black holes, they also created an explosion called a kilonova. Kilonovas are less bright than supernovas, but they're no less impactful, especially in this case. Because if mergers like this really were somewhere the R process could happen, the radioactive decay that creates all those heavier elements would also create a big ol' kilonova. So in order to confirm the R process is happening somewhere, you can watch for a kilonova. And after scientists detected GW170817, they found kilonova AT2017 GFO coming from the exact same part of the sky. Not with gravitational wave detectors, though. A kilonova emits a bunch of light, so it was picked up by regular telescopes, like the VLT in Chile and the Hubble up in space. It was a great example of astronomers around the world with different areas of expertise all working together. With this pair of astronomical signals in hand, astronomers were finally able to confirm the R process happens in neutron star mergers. We finally had a source for all those heavy elements, including, if you saw any of the news coverage, that shiny, glittery gold. But there's a problem, because after years of investigations, scientists still haven't found the chemical signature of gold in that kilonova light. They've found the telltale signs of other R process elements, like tungsten, but not gold. That doesn't necessarily mean it's not there. One study published in 2021 calculated that there could be up to 3,000 Earth's worth of gold made by that one explosion without our telescopes picking it up. P.S. That's not the amount of gold on Earth times 3,000, that's the entire mass of Earth times 3,000, so about 18 octillion kilograms. And that's a lot by our puny human standards, but that's a cosmic speck by the universes. And binary neutron star mergers seem to be pretty rare. And if you extrapolate, there's not enough gold being produced by these mergers to explain the total amount of gold in the universe. So scientists are back at the drawing board once again. Although this time, they didn't have to erase the whole thing. They just added a second, smaller drawing board beside the original one. For a while, they thought about attributing some R process element production to supernovas. You know, again. But just like before, that didn't pan out. Luckily, astronomers have a few alternates under consideration. Maybe mergers used to happen more than they do now. Maybe the S process is actually doing more work in pumping out heavier elements than we thought. Or maybe it's magnetars, which are fancy ultramagnetic neutron stars. Back in 2004, astronomers detected a magnetar flare called SGR-1806-20. It was so bright, telescopes couldn't even look at it directly to make some measurements. Astronomers had to rely on reflections off the moon. And 2 decades later, a team decided to take another look at this monster. They had originally been digging into a bunch of old telescope data, looking for evidence of the R process. Just a year before, a few members on the team had discovered that magnetar flares, under the right conditions, could trigger the R process. And when they stumbled across this super bright magnetar flare, they realized it met the criteria. Now, getting the R process to happen in a magnetar is a bit more complicated than in a merger. The outer layers of a magnetar, which is where the R process would have to happen, is pretty rich in neutrons, just not rich enough to do all the element synthesis we need it to do in the regular way. But according to this new study published in 2025, it can get around that deficit. As I mentioned earlier, the R process requires 2 basic parts. A ton of spare neutrons, and some seed nuclei for those neutrons to glom onto. And in the case of magnetars, the emphasis is on spare. The low-ish density and incredible speed of a magnetar flare makes it impossible for too many seed nuclei to form. But even though there's not technically enough neutrons to kickstart the R process the normal way, there are still way more neutrons than there are seed nuclei. Because of that neutron supply and demand, the R process can still create big balls of neutrons that get ejected out into the universe with the rest of the flare, and eventually decay into heavy elements. The study estimates that over the lifetime of our Milky Way, magnetar flares could be responsible for anywhere from 1 to 10% of all R process elements. But according to models, which admittedly were only based on this one event, magnetar flares are only really able to produce elements on the lighter end of the heavy element spectrum, like strontium and zirconium. In other words, no gold. So where all the universe's gold comes from remains a mystery, ditto with many of the other elements far beyond iron of the periodic table, including ones that are inside our bodies right now. But it's kind of understandable, given how extreme and infrequent the process seems to be to make them. Our observational pool for these sources is so small. While there are other kilonova candidates besides the one associated with GW170817, none has actually been confirmed. And SGR-1806-20 was a once-in-a-lifetime magnetar flare in terms of scale. We still have a lot of work to do to understand exactly where everything in the universe comes from, but for now, we can still say we're made of star stuff. We're just also made of a little more than that.